3, 2, 1, go.
Welcome to NYCBD with Jeffrey Hill on 710 WOR.
Welcome. I'm Jeffrey Hill, your host right here on 710 WOR Radio in New York City. With me is my producer, the Flipsinator. Good morning, Flips. How are you, bud?
Good. Just tired, as usual.
Okay, well, you know, I mean, it's a new day. It's an exciting show. We got to do an exciting show.
True.
So it's time for you to get fired up.
I am now.
Okay.
You fired me up.
There you go. There you go. That's my responsibility here. All right. Let's tell the folks how to find us. We're available right here every Sunday at 8 a.m. All right. We all know that. Then the show becomes available as a podcast on the iHeartRadio app, iTunes, and Spotify. Just search NYCBD with Jeffrey Hill. The show is also on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. We are also shooting the show live for you on YouTube, and all can be found at NYCBD Official. All right. An exciting thing is that Jimmy Cozier, who's been joining us off and on the show, has his entire video team here. So those are the guys behind the camera. Jimmy just called me up and said he has good news. I said, what is that good news, Mr. James? And he said, I'm officially going on tour, an R&B retro tour starting January 1st. How exciting is that,
Flips? That's cool.
Yeah, pretty cool, right? Okay, so Jimmy will be in and out on the show, but he's going to drop by, he told me, when he can. So we look forward to that and hearing about his exploits. Also with me is a gentleman that kind of joined us recently, Jay Contessa. He spent just a little bit of time on the show with us last week. So Jay, you may recall, spent about 30 years in the consumer packaged goods marketplace, working mostly for Unilever. I've known Jay a good portion of that time. Welcome back to the show, Jay.
Yeah, it's great to be here.
Okay. So Jay has spent the last couple of years in the cannabis arena, along with doing some of his own consumer packaged goods brands, and he's going to bring a lot of that perspective to the table as we move forward. Okay, so let's review the parts of the show. The first segment is called Cannabis in the Tri-State Plus One, where I will update you, as you know, on the key cannabis issues in all four states. The second segment is called Stunning and Amazing Facts, what I consider to be the most relevant issues and opportunities in the space since last week. Each segment is called a...
I'll leave this one to Jay.
There you go, Jay. Each segment is called a...
A moment.
All right, you can tell that he hasn't been with us that long. Each segment is called a Flips. Help him out here.
Stunner.
His cannabis is called a stunner. Thank you very much. All right, so we'll be going through that shortly. I like moment better. You know, a special moment. Very sincere, important, empathetic moment, I'm sure. For our third segment, today's guest, it will be my honor to focus my attention on Mr. Contessa over there. Lastly, we will end the show with our fourth segment called Your Messages, providing answers to the most interesting direct questions we received following last week's show. All right, we'll be back with the first segment, Cannabis in the Tri-State Plus One, right after this.
The Alchemist Kitchen celebrates the power of plants. They're the leading destination in New York City for CBD. Their organic CBD hemp flower is grown in upstate New York. So come on down and talk to one of their herbalists to learn about how CBD may relieve stress, anxiety, and pain. Located at 21 East 1st Street, right near the Bowery. Mention NYCBD for special savings for your first purchase. See you soon. Or visit them online at thealchemistkitchen.com. That's the A-L-C-H-E-M-I-S-T. kitchen.com.
Welcome back to NYCBD with Jeffrey Hill right here on 710 WOR Radio every Sunday at 8 a.m. You all know that the show becomes a podcast on virtually all podcast sites at NYCBD Official. We also have all the appropriate social media and a YouTube channel once again at NYCBD Official. I have a blog, which many of you are aware of, medium.com/@JeffreyHill2. That's medium.com/@JeffreyHill2, where I go deeper into the issues that we're discussing on the show. Okay, let's move on with the first segment, Cannabis in the Tri-State, Plus One, and let's begin with New York. Okay, for months, legislators in Albany, spurred on by criminal justice reform groups, debated various ways in which New York could legalize marijuana, just as states like California, Washington, and Alaska have done. But a proposed bill fell through in June. I think we all know that. Then, near the end of the legislative session, lawmakers reached a last-minute compromise. They passed a bill that would further decriminalize the possession of the drug and immediately expunge or seal records of low-level marijuana convictions across the state. New York started the process of expunging many of these records. A spokesman for Governor Cuomo said, "For too long, communities of color have been disproportionately impacted. We've heard this before, haven't we? The expunging of records is still being executed," officials said. The process could take up to a year, and Lucian Chalfen, a spokesman for the State Office of Court Administration, said at least a year in his judgment. Sealing the records will keep low-level marijuana-related criminal convictions from appearing in most background searches, state officials said. Well, let's talk about some numbers for a minute. About 160,000 people will have marijuana convictions cleared from their records in New York, said a spokesman for the State Division of Criminal Justice Services. Just think about that. 160,000 people that couldn't get a job, very likely, because they had this kind of a record, perhaps couldn't even get into training programs because this had this kind of a record. And now these records are going to be expunged, and they'll be able to get those jobs and perhaps do a better job with their family. So we're pretty excited about that. Let's move on to New Jersey. New Jersey cannabis consumers seek relief before 2020. Cannabis consumers across New Jersey are calling on legislators to find an immediate solution. Are you ready for this? To stop arresting nearly 100 people. How often, Jay, how often do you think that they're arresting 100 people in the state of New Jersey, where it's basically legal in states all around them?
Probably every day.
Not only every day, how about 100 people every day for possessing small amounts of marijuana? Yeah. Taxpayers are spending millions to put handcuffs on marijuana consumers, the same people who are expected to come out to the polls and vote for a constitutional amendment, said Garden State Normal Executive Director Charlana McKeithen. With another day for full legalization, we hope elected officials will explore every option to stop these needless arrests. All right, that's an interesting comment. In addition to supporting full legalization, the Garden State supports the criminalization of marijuana, utilizing civil fines for all ages. The process requires no arrest, no handcuffs, no custody, no court, no jail, no supervision, no treatment, and no permanent record. Fines are usually between $25 and $100. 21 states and over 100 cities have already enacted these provisions. And as you've just heard, so has New York, the adjacent state. Unfortunately, lawmakers in Trenton have elected to kick the can further down the road and allow tens of thousands more New Jersey residents to be saddled with criminal records for marijuana offenses due to their lack of action. Now, this is fascinating. We've talked about this before. Here's a state with a governor that has made a commitment within his first 100 days to get adult use cannabis legal in the state, which he failed at, right? Now it's going to go.
Miserably.
Thank you very much, Flips. Miserably would be correct. Now he's going to go, right? And they're going to have a referendum because he couldn't get the agreement of the assembly, right? 15 bills, marijuana bills, all went in front of the assembly, which was basically totally confusing. They couldn't come out with the one bill that was going to work. So as a result, the assembly and the governor let down that state. Now it's going to go to a public referendum. In the meantime, why are they arresting all these people? Yeah, everybody knows it's going to be adult use legal.
Yeah.
Yet they're arresting 100 people a day in some instances. That's astounding. Is that not astounding?
Yeah, it makes no sense.
They have a quota to fill.
Well, there you go, right. Because indeed, that's where I was going next. They have a quota to fill. So I understand and respect policemen having quotas. We've talked about this on other shows. There's nothing wrong with policemen having quotas because they effectively have to pay for themselves. I get that. But do they have to fill the quota among cannabis-only offenders, which is really going to change their lives indefinitely?
Yeah.
And yet in 5 months' time, this stuff's going to be legal.
Yeah.
It's astounding.
Yeah.
I'm not sure I get it. So when these people go in front of the judge, the judge is going to say, "You're wasting my time." However, the law is the law, and they're going to have to sentence these people until such time as they choose to decriminalize, right, and hopefully ultimately expunge. All right, we would move on to Connecticut, but I did a lot of homework all week long, and nothing happened in Connecticut. So for you Connecticut folks, you know, I look forward to hearing from you. All right, on with Massachusetts, and as you know, Massachusetts does things all the time, right? So Mass has banned vape sales more than 2 months ago, and now business in New Hampshire and Maine is booming. All right, well said. The cars with Massachusetts license plate pull into gas stations and vape shops in New Hampshire pretty steadily every day. The people inside them ready to stock up on electronic cigarettes they can't buy in their home state of Massachusetts. Along the border in New Hampshire and Maine, sales of nicotine and cannabis vaping products have boomed since September 24th, when Massachusetts Governor Charlie Baker banned both. Amid an outbreak of vaping-related lung injuries, at one cannabis dispensary in Biddeford, Maine, vape sales have risen 76%. At another dispensary, they've actually increased 100%. It's putting me through so much extra hassle, says Kevin Nimera, a 30-year-old from Harvard, who said, I've come up at least four or five times. It feels better for me. I really don't want to go back to real cigarettes because it's that noticeable to my health, but I can't keep coming up here. The state's rapid decline in sales of traditional cigarettes has also slowed. So keep in mind, ladies and gentlemen, that a lot of people have moved to electronic cigarettes as a replacement for cigarette smoking, right? And I don't think there's too many oncologists that wouldn't agree that if you were going to smoke, now if you're going to smoke, we all agree you shouldn't smoke, but if you were going to smoke, you're significantly better off from a health perspective smoking electronic cigarettes than you are from burning tobacco. I think we can all agree with that, and that data has been well documented. Okay, the state estimated that its $331 million a year vaping industry would lose millions of dollars in sales. The ban is actually supposed to be lifted, but vape businesses in nearby states expect the stream of Massachusetts customers to continue because Baker recently signed into law the nation's toughest ban on flavored tobacco and nicotine vaping products. So while there's back and forth in Massachusetts and Baker is starting to open up a little bit in the CBD arena, et cetera, he's making it more difficult in the electronic cigarette business. These things are all businesses, right? It ought to be, you know, I mean, selectively challenged. So let me go back through this one more time, right? Which is, it's pretty much been isolated. The vape crisis has been pretty much isolated to three companies and those that bring in an e-acetone into the product. Most of these are bootlegs. Virtually none of them, I don't believe any of them, have been sold in a dispensary. Okay? So, what have we done here? I used the term the last time, don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. Keep the baby, throw out the bathwater. So I'm going to use it again. What does that mean? That means find the guys that are making a mess of things and take them off the shelves. I say this every week. You know, I don't understand why it doesn't happen more regularly. Anyway. Okay, then. So that concludes our first segment, Cannabis in the Tri-State Plus One, with a little bit of editorial from me. We'll be back with our next segment, Stunning and Amazing Facts, with our first stunner right after this.
The Alchemist Kitchen celebrates the power of plants. They're the leading destination in New York City for CBD. Their organic CBD hemp flower is grown in upstate New York. So come on down and talk to one of their herbalists to learn about how CBD may relieve stress, anxiety, and pain. Located at 21 East 1st Street, right near the Bowery. Mention NYCBD for special savings for your first purchase. See you soon. Or visit them online at thealchemistkitchen.com. That's the A-L-C-H-E-M-I-S-T kitchen.com.
Welcome back to NYCBD with Jeffrey Hill, right here on 710 WOR Radio every Sunday at 8 a.m. We're also available on virtually all podcast sites. That's Spotify, iHeartRadio, and iTunes at NYCBD Official. And I strongly suggest you start thinking about our YouTube channel because I've got so many cameras in front of me. I got to believe the YouTube is going to be spectacular. Okay. That's also
And you get to see the vests too.
The vests, that's right. You guys have no idea what our overall, shall we say, fashion forward statement looks like. So let's take a quick look at Flipsy, Mr. Orange over there. He's Knicks and a hoodie all in orange.
Yeah, so the sneakers.
As an homage to the worst basketball team perhaps in the NBA today.
Pretty much, yeah.
And then if you look to your left, you'll see that our guest Jay Contessa kind of has that Fairfield County look about him, you know, the sweater, etc. There's no question he's a Fairfield County boy, which of course we know he is. Then there's moi. Okay, you can make your own judgments. All right. Stunner number one, the California marijuana.
How many vests do you have?
I have enough so that I rarely have to overlap.
Okay. Oh wow.
Yes. Okay. So, you know, I'd like you to count them and we'll see how we do.
That's a closet and a half.
We can do an over and under on the vests if you'd like, and I'll take the over. All right. Let's move on with stunner number one. The California marijuana tax hike puts the future of the legal market in the spotlight amid worries over the state industry's viability. What does that mean? Flurries of meetings and negotiations have occurred behind the scenes in Sacramento since California announced a cannabis tax increase last month. The state made only $345 million in cannabis taxes in 2018. Notice I said only. That was kind of a joke. Nobody laughed. All right. With over 55,000 full-time jobs and revenue of approximately $3 billion.
Wow.
But like all new sources of income, the state wants how much? Well, they want more. Will it kill this new industry and push it more into the black market? The stakes surrounding these discussions are very high because many of us would like to see the taxes maintained at a reasonable level. Think about that, ladies and gentlemen. In the state of Colorado, as an example, the legal market outdoes the illegal market 4-1.
Is this the only state doing it right?
Colorado?
Yeah.
Let's say they're doing it the most right, okay. Right? And then in the state of California, which has a bigger cannabis business than all other states combined, I might add, that $3 billion I mentioned, right?
But the people are also lazy. So.
There's still 80% of that market that's illegal and 20% that's legal, or at least 1-4. Mm-hmm. So what does that mean? If they're doing $3 billion in legal, multiply that by 4, they're doing $12 billion in illegal. The higher the taxes go, there's got to be some balancing act there, right? I mean, like, where do you reach the point of diminishing returns? Taxes go up, and all of a sudden you start pushing people that want to do it legally into the illegal market again. So you got to be very, very careful, right? So representatives from multiple cannabis companies and trade organizations spoke with staffers in Governor Gavin Newsom's office, the California Department of Tax and Fee Administration, also known as, are you ready for this, the CDTFA, and multiple state legislators with the aim of shoring up political support to do what? To lower tax burdens on legal marijuana businesses. The state, as I said, made $345 million. That seems like a big number. And as more people move from the illegal to the legal market, that number is going to go up geometrically. Why continue to put more taxes on the people that are doing it right? Well, I'm not totally sure. All right, let's move on to the next stunner. This is quite remarkable. Canopy Growth Corp said Monday it has named David Klein, currently chief financial officer of its biggest shareholder, Constellation Brands, as its new chief executive, taking over from Mark Zekelin on January 14th, who replaced founder and CEO Bruce Linton. Let's see what the $7.5 billion Constellation Brands enterprise can do for this much-derided cannabis company, a firm that was showing $23 billion in valuation in late April, early May, but missed projections consistently, forcing management changes. All right, so let's talk about that for a minute. Constellation Brands, Jay, invests $4 billion, right? Constellation, maker of Corona, maker of Mortadello. Yep. They got like a bunch of spirits, et cetera. Right. Enormous U.S. business, right?
Right.
That immediately creates a sense of reality in the early days of cannabis, what's called LPs, legal producers, and Canopy Growth was the beneficiary of that.
Right.
All right, at the time, they have Bruce. Bruce is the CEO, founder, did a great job, right? Builds the fits the firm up, gets the $4 billion, et cetera. Unfortunately, once that took place and all that visibility began to happen, he had to make numbers, didn't he?
Right.
Quarter-to-quarter numbers becomes the game. Yeah. When you've got three people from Constellation Brands or any serious business people on your board expecting you to make numbers.
Right.
Well, he promised $1 billion running, right? Didn't get it. So what happened? They moved in and they replaced them, right?
Yep.
So now they're even putting their own person on the board.
Right.
So what do you think is the likelihood of a guy that was the CFO of a beverage company focusing on spirits being successful in the cannabis space? What's your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, usually it's a tough one. Usually it's a marketing person, someone that can drive the brands and understands that. And when you try to drive them financially, sometimes that's not usually the right position, but there's been successful people that have done it. So,
yeah, of course. You know, I'm about to get on a plane for Las Vegas because the National Cannabis Show is this week, and I'm on my way to Vegas for all 3 days of this show, right? I'm going to bring the show out there, so we're going to have a lot of interviews in the future, right? And here's what's fascinating. There's an industry that has finance people running it. I'm about to pay $5 for the blanket, $2 for the pillow. I think it's $3.50 for the headphones,
right?
All of which used to be free.
Yeah.
My lunch is $12, but because I'm taking JetBlue, I get free snacks. Right. If I took Delta, I'd get free what? Free nothing.
Nothing.
There's no such thing as free.
Right.
All right, that's what happens sometimes. Sometimes, I'm not suggesting all the time, to your point, when you put financial people running what really is kind of a marketing-based, consumer packaged good kind of an orientation, or a healthcare company.
Right.
So it's a challenge. Let's see what happens. All right, next stunner. Representative Ro Khanna, Democrat from California, tweeted 663,367 people were arrested for cannabis-only offenses, which compares to the total incarcerated population in 1988 of 627,000. What does that mean? That means that while there's 33 states medicinally legal, 11 states adult use legal, and the comments I made earlier about what's happening in New Jersey, it's not just New Jersey, 663,000 people arrested. All right, let's run some math. We love math, don't we, Jay? We're math guys, right? So here we go.
I'm out.
Okay, that's exactly right. Let me say it differently. Let's use the number 1 plus 1, and then we get flips involved. All right, now. All right, so assuming a cost of $50,000 to $70,000 a year for the annual cost of keeping someone in our prison system, the cost of the government is roughly, run those numbers, 663,000 times that number is roughly $33 billion to keep cannabis-only offenders in jail. Well, I don't know. But that could go a long way to helping with fixing some bridges, maybe building a few schools, improving the education system. They just cut PE from half the classes that I'm aware of. They're cutting the art music programs.
Right.
So I don't know. $33 billion goes a long way. There's a lot of teachers that could be paid for that. What do you think?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I mean,
it's pretty remarkable, isn't it?
Right. You got to get the priorities.
So this
right.
goes back to the issue of, you know, of quartering and things of that nature. It's, you know, I mean, all these things are interrelated, ladies and gentlemen. And that's the reason why this show talks about cannabis every week, because this show addresses all of the issues that we face on a macro level. We address black-white issues here, right? Mm-hmm. We address government versus state issues here. We address international issues, political issues, investment issues. This space is a microcosm of virtually everything that exists, you know, essentially in this democratic nation.
Yeah.
Really, it's quite remarkable, really.
Yeah.
It's like it's like a giant test market that is just beginning. And we are certainly experiencing some, shall we say, growing pains.
Yeah,
all right.
Yeah.
Next stunner. People are skipping sleep aids in favor of marijuana, several studies report. The scientific community is still unclear on whether or not marijuana can actually help treat sleep disturbances. I can only speak to my own experience. I started taking CBD. I was a regular Ambien user. I took Ambien for 4 years to go to sleep. I started taking CBD, and I have no trouble sleeping. I'm not saying it's cause and effect. Perhaps it's partially placebo, right? But the bottom line is I'm not taking Ambien anymore. That's just my own experience, all right? A new study, however, found that fewer people purchase over-the-counter sleep aids or sleep medications when they have legal access to cannabis. Our results show that the market share growth for sleep aids shrank with the entry of recreational cannabis dispensaries by more than 200% relative to the mean market share growth in our sample. So, at the risk of getting too detailed here, you know, we're very quantitative, and when we look at analytics, we need to make sure they're real and they can be projected, and that's kind of what that means. Researchers at the University of New Mexico and California State Polytechnic University used retail scan data collected by Nielsen. We got access to that data and showed you what the affected sales were in OTC sleep medications, and those are the numbers. All right, on to the next stunner. People suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD, which we've been discussing for quite some time. And last week, of course, we had Derek on. Derek was an ex-Marine who did 2 tours and even wrote a book about PTSD. Right, here's another study that says significantly fewer depressive episodes and lower rates of suicide, ideation, and execution can be directly associated to users of cannabis. Huh. The research published in the Journal of Psychopharmacology, there's one of my favorite words, psychopharmacology. I know that one, right? That's not a new one, right? I didn't have to study that for this show.
Can you say it 3 times fast?
I can, but I don't want to do it now because I have it's valuable airtime. But anytime I use a 4-syllable word,
smart,
half my audience basically changes the channel. All right, so stay with me, ladies and gentlemen. All right, so among the more than 24,000 people who are eligible for the study, which was conducted by researchers at the British Columbia Center on Substance Use and Abuse at the University of British Columbia, 420 were clinically diagnosed with PTSD. Of those, 28% said they used cannabis in the past year. That's markedly higher than the average who don't have PTSD who also use cannabis at 11%, right? So 22%, 28% of PTSD patients are using it versus the average of 11%. And what did they notice? They noticed significantly alleviated symptoms. However, this is the first time that quantitative results have been captured that I have seen in this area. There's many other results that I have not seen. I'm not suggesting that's the case. And this has shown major potential and is going to continue to be analyzed, as we said, by a number of folks, okay? Those suffering from PTSD who didn't report past year cannabis use were about seven times, let me repeat that, seven times as likely to have experienced a recent major depressive episode than those who were cannabis users. So I don't know. If I have depression and I read a study that says, right, if I don't use it, I'm seven times more likely to have continued depressive episodes. What do you think, Jay?
I mean,
what are you going to tell your kids?
Yeah,
right?
You have to.
Right, you're
going to
tell your kids, let's go get a medicinal marijuana license,
absolutely,
aren't we? And let's go try to figure out a way to manage this depressive state, right, without necessarily going to all the drugs that are typically used. I'm not suggesting Wellbutrin and Rexulti and the other drugs don't make sense. They do make sense.
Right.
But perhaps we should be considering the power of plants, right, to add to wellness since the data seems quite overwhelming.
Yeah.
All right, so that's it, ladies and gentlemen. That is the end of our stunning and amazing facts section with a bunch of stunners. When we come back, we're going to move to the third segment of our show and have some more conversation with Jay. I look forward to that. See you soon.
The Alchemist Kitchen celebrates the power of plants. They're the leading destination in New York City for CBD. Their organic CBD hemp flower is grown in upstate New York. So come on down and talk to one of their herbalists to learn about how CBD may relieve stress, anxiety, and pain. Located at 21 East 1st Street, right near the Bowery. Mention NYCBD for special savings for your first purchase. See you soon. Or visit them online at thealchemistkitchen.com. That's the A-L-C-H-E-M-I-S-T. Kitchen.com.
Welcome back to NYCBD with Jeffrey Hill right here on 710 WOR Radio. We're also available as a podcast right after the show on Spotify, iTunes, and iHeartRadio. Just search at NYCBD Official and you're good to go. All right? We also have a YouTube channel. And of course, you know, I have a blog, medium.com/@JeffreyHill2. That's medium.com/@JeffreyHill2. All right, great. Let's move on to the third segment of our show, today's guest. You guys have heard from Jay quite a bit during the show. Jay was kind enough to agree to come to the whole show. Most of our guests kind of jump in and jump out because obviously they're busy folks and they have a lot to do. All right.
Jay's just not busy.
Yeah, exactly.
I prefer to say that Jay has prioritized his time and realizes that this is a top priority. But thank you very much, Mr. Flips. All right. So moving on. So let me remind the group what I said earlier. Jay has had a 30-plus year career in senior sales management with consumer packaged goods, working mostly for the Unilever Corporation, which, as you may know, is a $90 billion global consumer packaged goods business. Competes typically with folks like P&G, probably their number one competitor. Also competes with Colgate and a whole host of others in the in a number of different categories. They are dominant internationally in many countries. And they're fighting it out kind of brick by brick, if you say, if I guess stealing my own phrase, kind of inch by inch here in the U.S. with some big players, right? Jay has been in the cannabis space for about 2 years now. All right, so Jay, this has been a pretty interesting transition for you, right? Having come from kind of where I came from, right?
Correct.
Lots and lots of years in consumer packaged goods land. This category has over, count them, 7,000 boutique brands. Think about that, ladies and gentlemen. Think about toothpaste. If we had 7,000 brands, I think the aisle would be a little overweighted. I don't know, right?
Yep.
We got about six brands in toothpaste, and they've got about 40 different flavors, don't they, right?
Exactly.
This category at 7,000 brands is quite interesting. How, speaking on behalf of the CPG universe, how are they thinking about this space?
Yeah, I think, Jeff, just like everybody else, they are very excited about the opportunity that this space will provide, especially if there's real benefits. You know, a lot of times it's fairy dust, you know, that you put in a brand to grab a benefit. But here, you know, as all the studies that you've shown and that we're reading about, some of the benefits, whether it's from skincare, hair care, or in water, or you know, anywhere, are really some tremendous benefits that the consumer will actually realize. You know, to your point, stops you know changing my sleeping pattern by just changing my brand to something that's natural. is a huge benefit for all of these CPG companies.
I know. So, you know, having been a CPG person for a long time, dating myself, Scope mouthwash 1,000 years ago.
Yep.
All right, so my first job, I graduated UMass on Friday. I'm on Scope mouthwash on Monday. I was in a city called Cincinnati. I got off the plane. I was a Massachusetts boy. I got off the plane, and it said, "Welcome to Kentucky," and I literally, this is a true story, I literally ran back down the terminal and said, "Oh, my God, I got off at the wrong place."
Yeah, yeah.
And this wonderful flight attendant said, "Well, where are you going? And I said, "Well, I'm going to Cincinnati."
Over the bridge.
And after she got done laughing, she said, "This is the greater Cincinnati airport. Happens to be based in Kentucky."
Yeah.
All right, so I get that. So now, just kind of bringing it back home a little bit. So we invented diseases there, right? Mm-hmm. In other words, sure. We invented bad breath, morning breath. Morning breath isn't a real disease.
Right.
Morning breath is when you sleep all night long, you have dry mouth because you've been breathing through your mouth.
Right.
Well, the research says consumers think that that's bad breath, and so we invented a commercial. Man rolls over, gives wife a kiss. Wife says, "Oh, my God, honey." He runs in, takes the mouthwash, boom, boom, comes back, great kiss. Okay, so it smells minty fresh, not medicine, and kills morning breath.
Right.
Okay, great. Medicine, of course, was Listerine.
Yep.
Right? So there you go, an invented disease. All right, so here's what I worry about. There's great medicinal value associated with this brand. We've been documenting it show after show after show.
Absolutely.
Why is it in shampoo? Why is it in some of these other things?
Yep.
What is it doing in some of these kind of like ancillary brands, right? Where I don't think the medicinal value of the brand is real.
Yep.
I saw a brand the other day that was impregnated clothing with CBD in it.
Yeah, I saw
right?
that.
Now, I love that if it's bike pants and yep. it's got some kind of a dispensing powder
right.
that as I bike more, it dispenses it onto my thighs because
right.
that's an anti-inflammatory.
Yep.
But what I don't like is when they just kind of throw it anywhere.
Right.
Thoughts on that, please.
Yeah, no, I think one of the things or area of brand that I worked with did it with skincare. And obviously, bags under your eyes is inflammation. And what does CBD provide? Relief of inflammation. So I think
okay, brilliantly said. Brilliantly
you know,
said, yes.
They're thinking that there is some
sure
value
is.
Of relieving that inflammation. So,
right.
Unnaturally.
Right. So let's move from there and talk about your old company, Unilever, who, of course, you know, is kind of very focused in the skincare category
yep.
and the hair care category and a
right.
whole host of other categories.
Correct.
So let's talk a little bit about CPG and how you see it, Unilever's perspective. But let's talk about the other CPG brands you're familiar with as well, please.
Yeah, so I think as we've heard, like a Unilever, obviously with Ben & Jerry's has made an announcement that would be an opportunity brand for them. I am sure every brand within Unilever is already well positioned and knows exactly what they're going to do when the regulations and customers. So you still have to have that customer hurdle. So Target will not allow a CBD brand in there. Amazon, I don't believe, allows a CBD brand to be posted. So,
first of all, Amazon does, but let's move on. But let's go back to talk to me a little bit about something you're very familiar with. Let's talk about the drug trade with the three big drug players.
Yep.
What's going on there?
Yeah, so the drug trade, you have Walgreens and CVS, and so again, Unilever is going to make sure that if they're going to service 20,000 retail outlets in the drug end, that everything is passed through clearance, that it's FDA regulated, the labels are correct, that there is no chance of anything backfiring on them. Remember, brands are like children, and you want to protect the children.
That's an excellent analogy. Go ahead.
They can't afford a misstep in this space. So. They're gonna move with caution, but move with speed. If that makes sense. But,
sure. So let's talk a little bit about the three drug players: Rite Aid, CVS, and Walgreens
yep.
that you mentioned. Okay,
mm-hmm.
so they're brands also, right? In fact,
correct.
Some could argue that they're more powerful as a brand
absolutely.
Than the players that are inside there. Of course, P&G and Unilever and a whole host of
yeah,
other
sure.
folks would have a slightly different point of view on that,
absolutely.
Wouldn't they?
Yeah.
All right, so they are all carrying, right? So
mm-hmm.
all three of them have chosen to carry in certain states CBD products.
Correct.
However, they have drawn a distinction between oral ingested product
correct.
And transdermal product.
Right.
Talk about that, please.
Yeah, I think everybody's nervous about anything that's ingested. So I think that's where, from an FDA standpoint, that's where you see the hammer come down in that space. I think oral, whether it's topical for face cream or things of that nature, it seems to have gotten a clear path forward at this point. That there's been no recall, there's been no legislation or you know, somebody slapping them on the wrist.
Right. There's a lot of letters, which is appropriate,
right.
You know, going out, challenging claims
right.
from small companies that are saying crazy things, which
right.
is the FDA's responsibility.
Right.
But, you know, kind of what I find interesting is if you understand the medicinal side of the space, CBD, you know, delivered in a salve, right?
Right.
Transdermally,
yep.
not unlike Nicorette or Nicoderm,
yeah, right.
which is a patch right?
right?
Is a systemic product,
mm-hmm.
meaning when you put it on through the skin, on the external portion of the skin, it goes into the system anyway.
Correct.
So there's very little difference medicinally.
Right.
Between one and the other, except speed of activation, which is often referred to as bioavailability,
right.
which is how much of the product, how long does it take for the product that you're putting on to get into the system
right.
and become bioavailable, meaning available to the body,
yep.
right? So while that indeed seems to be the line or the hurdle, internal ingestion, oral ingestion versus transdermal, right, it's kind of interesting because when you begin to understand the science, you can actually question whether or not that hurdle is viable or not.
Right.
All right, let's talk a little bit about some other folks you're familiar with. Let's talk about Nestle and what they're doing, please.
Yeah, so Nestle's an interesting one. Obviously, they just bought a Canadian company that's gotten them into the CBD. So here's a big, you know, national, you know, consumer product company that is now entered through acquisition. So it'll be interesting to see, you know, how they roll that out. But they, you know, if you read what they looked at is that they're in multiple categories within healthcare, and obviously CBD is one of those parts that will play a big role, I'm sure, moving forward.
Let me ask you this. So when I was consulting for you, I might add,
yeah.
and I was want to know that I was very thankful for all the money that you helped me make in the consulting community. I want to thank you for that. I want to thank Unilever as well.
Yes,
okay, so Jay, so you know, you've been selling for an awfully long time, and you know, when Nestle, to your point, has a number of other SKUs in the supplementation arena, right? When they go to a retailer, right, as Nestle,
yep.
representing multiple brands within supplementation,
yep.
I want you to kind of educate the audience on the kind of leverage they can create through trade programming and other kinds of things that almost forces their way to the shelf, please.
Yeah, so, you know, obviously when you have the power brands that Nestle has, You're able to bundle those up, so you're not talking about just CBD or just water. You bring in the whole package together, and that gives you tremendous amount of leverage, you know, in some of these big customers. So they're able to call it utilize their scale for not only distribution, one or two SKUs, but maybe 20 SKUs. So you know, they really can have a play havoc, you know, inside the category.
Righto, and I, you know, we have a lot of entrepreneurs, small CBD brands, people looking at the space, rolling up brands, doing all kinds of things. I want to just remind everyone that these are the things that go on behind the scenes that are not often seen. So the 7,000 CBD brands that are out there, you know, when they go up against Nestle and their powerhouse portfolio, or when Unilever comes in with their powerhouse portfolio, or any other players step up, you can be sure that they're going to use the combined leverage of the entire portfolio, and that's going to put many of these 7,000 brands into a world of hurt.
Right.
All right, let me talk about one other. And this is an old friend of ours mutually, all right? The Schottenstein family, many know, are major investors in Albertsons, the number three food retailer in the country now,
right.
DSW, right? And American Eagle,
yeah.
right? So that's, I don't know how many stores that is. Call
right.
that 1,000 stores, probably more,
yeah.
right?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, so what have they done? They've invested in a brand called GGB. GGB is now publicly traded, and they have many CBD offsets, right?
Right.
So with the power that they represent, they, A, went out and got a senior sales executive, quite a brilliant individual that you and I both know.
Yeah.
Someday we might have him on the show,
yeah.
right? But they are also planning on putting distribution into Albertsons, where
right.
they already have an ownership stake, yeah. as well as American Eagle and DSW,
yeah.
which is kind of stunning, right?
Right, right.
Having said all of that, there are CBD brands and Urban Outfitter,
right?
Which is even more stunning. I mean,
yeah.
what is a supplementation brand doing in clothing businesses, Jay, in your
yeah,
judgment?
Well, I think, you know, the world has changed. When you and I first started, there was no such thing as another small brand. It was big brands or no brands. And now, though, you do see boutique brands making their way in it. And, you know, it's whether it's Barney's, right, that before their collapse, you know, it was a showplace for some of these.
Third time into Chapter 11. Yeah. Maybe we shouldn't use Barney's, but go ahead. But your point's a good one.
But, you know,
they brought Bebo in. They brought a bunch of other players in. Yes.
These brands were made famous through these retailers. Or it's Target. You know, look what Target's doing, bringing in some of these boutique brands. Harry's. You know, Harry's was an internet business and then went to Target as a showcase. So,
you're talking about Harry's as in the digitally native vertical skin, shaving kit.
Shaving kit.
Just bought by Schick, right?
Yep.
Now, did they go to Target after they got bought by Schick because of Schick's leverage?
No. So they went on their own. So again, they were able to offer Target a boutique kind of
a one-off.
One-off.
Only available here.
Right. So you can go on the internet or you can buy it here at Target.
Right. And, so let me remind everybody. This is a funny one and it shows yet again some advanced age. So I wrote a piece in 1980 something called Who Will Own the Consumer in the 1990s, the manufacturer, the retailer. So here we are, 28 years later ish from 1990, and the game has been fought for all 28 years, hasn't it?
Right.
So Target believes they own the retail. They own the consumer.
Absolutely.
Right? Because they've got Kirkland, which they believe is the most powerful brand in their store, and they're bringing in their own products because they have Costco users that are loyal, right?
Correct.
And so CVS is an example, and we could go on through this. Rite Aid, all these guys, they've consolidated the entire drug industry. There's only three of them left,
correct.
Right?
Yep.
Wholesale clubs, it's down to basically Sam's, BJ's, and Costco,
correct.
Right?
That's
so,
it.
Boom.
Yeah.
Right? So the retail community believes that they have a birthright in brand.
Yeah, Wegmans.
Right.
One of the
I don't disagree.
Yeah.
We go all the way back with Danny Wegman, don't we?
Yeah. Wegmans. I mean, the power of Wegmans brand is unbelievable because the consumer has a great experience. They also associate them with being good branders.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly right.
With so that same experience.
As a reminder, when Wegmans just opened in
Brooklyn,
there was, I believe, a crowd of 1,000 people that got
lines around the block,
got there before it opened, right?
Yeah, tens of thousand people.
Right. So the point that we're making, right, is that the branding battle is not just a battle of the manufacturer, the Unilevers, if you will, but it's also a branding battle of the retail community, which used to just have what was called private label, and most of us kind of thought of it as second-class citizen,
correct.
But not anymore.
No.
Now it's as good or better than nationally branded goods.
Yeah.
So the battle rages on. What does this mean to CBD? I think what it does is it fundamentally challenges the existing brands in the marketplace to establish themselves with a beachhead quickly and get big as fast as they can.
Awesome.
Or when the tsunami of senior players comes in, they roll right out to sea. Your thoughts on that?
Yeah, no, I agree. Or they got to hope that they get acquired as a lead brand within the CPG world.
Right. Right,
just like we saw happen with Lord Jones, you know, $300 million someone paid for.
Right.
Right.
Oh, so for those of you who don't know, Lord Jones, a CBD brand that kind of looks like a brand that ought to go into Sephora, kind of like a cosmetic-looking brand, did indeed sell for $300 million. And that is Jay's point, and that certainly is a goal of virtually every CBD company that I'm aware of. Right?
Sure.
All right, so let's move on. CBD is federally legal and can cross state lines, but some governors want the hemp to be produced in their state. So, you know, the governor Baker said, "I want Massachusetts CBD to have their hemp produced in Massachusetts."
Right.
And others have said that, right?
Right?
Mitch McConnell from Kentucky has made that case, et cetera,
right.
et cetera. So how do you see CPG companies reacting to that?
They'll definitely go and fight that because it's impossible for a CPG company to have a brand for Massachusetts, which is a different brand than Rhode Island, than Connecticut and New York.
Different raw material, right?
Yeah.
The same brand, different raw material.
Yeah,
right.
You know, so there's no way that anybody can do that. I think in the short term, I thought maybe it was probably a good idea for them to, you know, hopefully keep their brand, you know, like the farmer local. But I think this space is going to be a little bit different as it hits the Target in Massachusetts and the, you know, the Stop and Shop and all that. Those brands are going to need to be represented in those stores, and that can't come from the little guy. He can handle two stores, one store. He can't handle chains. They're not built for that.
Yeah, it's interesting. So, I mean, I think what you'll see is there's always that segment. You mentioned Wegmans and Stop and Shop and a whole host of others. There's always that segment in these stores that it says buy local, right? That little segment says buy local. Right. And I think you will see some CBD brands that are produced with the hemp in that local market.
Right.
But broadly, as you were saying, the big brands are going to advertise, they're going to do it nationally,
right,
and they're going to become a force not only in the United States, but in many other countries around the world as well, right? Okay, great. So, if you were sitting with your old friend Alan Jope, currently CEO Unilever, we all grew up with him. I remember Alan when he was the I think the assistant brand manager, the brand manager on Ponds. Amazing
great
guy.
Great leader.
Also good golfer, I might add.
Yeah, right? Great golfer, good leader.
Exactly, sure is. All right, what would you encourage him to do in this space?
You know, Alan's a smart guy. I am sure he's got every one of the Unilever brands perfectly positioned and ready to go. So I think that's, you know, that'll be their strength, right, is when they need to enter the category. And it may be different brands at different times. So they may have a strategic rollout that says, you know, Ben & Jerry's is a good one. Axe, you know, would be, to me, you know, a no-brainer.
Remind the audience what Axe is, please.
So Axe is a, you know, for young teenagers brand.
A deodorant product.
A deodorant, right? Yeah, it's deodorant fragrances, and, you know, it continues to.
Right, and just for the audience's benefit, Axe was a remarkable introduction. They compete boldly with Procter & Gamble, who has Sure and Secret, and a number, Right Guard, and a number of other products, right? And along comes Unilever, kind of like under the cloak of darkness, and they come out with a brand called Axe, entirely positioned at the 13 to 17 year old male, because they decided that young men were getting independent. They don't want to buy, they don't want to use dad's deodorant.
Correct.
And they're 100% right. And they built a brand completely and totally targeted to the young community.
Correct.
And, you know, the CBD product ingredient, raw material, to your point, could be ideal for them.
Right.
Right.
So I think there's certain brands that, it fits naturally from what the brand position is. And there's other brands that they'll probably move a little bit more cautiously. You know, like, to me, I'd be a little nervous on Dove, you know, just because of the, you know, it's just such a powerful brand. It's got a powerful position. Does the CBD fit within the brand? Now, if it's about getting rid of puffiness around your eyes, and you're a leader in that space, then it does. But it may not make sense.
So perhaps Ponds, for example.
Yeah, Ponds, for example, all natural anyway, right?
Right.
You know, beeswax and mineral oil. So, you know, adding a CBD makes perfect sense.
Right.
It fits within the, you know, the
within the framework of the brand.
Yeah.
So for those of us that are in marketing for as long as Jay and I both have, we would call that kind of the brand architecture. So if the brand architecture kind of defines itself as a product, that the benefit of which can be improved by inflammation management recovery, right? I.e., perhaps Ponds, as he mentioned a moment ago,
right,
then it's got a natural birthright in the space.
Right.
If not, it looks like a force, doesn't it?
Correct.
All right, so if you were going to project the future a little bit, right, where do you personally, from your vantage point, see the cannabis category going?
Yeah, I think, Jeff, there's not, everybody, I don't care what brand it is talking about, you know, this space. So in my career, I've never seen a single ingredient or a single, you know, call it added piece that will go into brands that will be as big as CBD.
Yeah, it's got like an acai alpha hydroxy acid feel, and even bigger than both of those, right?
Yeah, right, because it's in, from your beer to your skincare,
right,
you know, to your hair care.
Right.
It's everywhere. And it, you know, to your point, if the brand architect works, then it'll fit in within those brands. And it seems to be, you know, when you look at some of them, like water, God, it makes sense. Like alcohol, you know, or like beer, it makes sense. Skincare makes sense. So it's hard to find some spots that it doesn't make sense.
Interesting. You know, so I think interesting perspective.
Huge.
So I think, ladies and gentlemen, that for those of you who are going into, shall we say, brand consulting, if you had a sub-emphasis on CBD based on everything Jay just said, your consulting firm stands to do well.
Yeah.
All right. Listen, Jay, it's you know, it's always good to see you.
Likewise,
right?
Jeff.
And we spent a lot of good time together and have over the years. So I want to thank you for coming down to the iHeartRadio headquarters here.
Yeah, beautiful.
And here we are in the KTU studio, even though we say WOR radio, because Flipsy over there managed to get us what I refer to as the big show.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
so great. When we are in the WOR, you know, studio, while it's quite lovely and we appreciate them, of course, it's not nearly as grandiose as this place. And because we knew you were coming, we wanted to take out, shall we say, get us into the big show.
Yeah, right.
All right. I want to thank you again for coming. Ladies and gentlemen, when we come back, we'll move to the next segment of our show, Your Messages. Come on right back.
The Alchemist Kitchen celebrates the power of plants. They're the leading destination in New York City for CBD. Their organic CBD hemp flower is grown in upstate New York. So come on down and talk to one of their herbalists to learn about how CBD may relieve stress, anxiety, and pain. Located at 21 East 1st Street, right near the Bowery. Mention NYCBD for special savings for your first purchase. See you soon. Or visit them online at thealchemistkitchen.com. That's the A-L-C-H-E-M-I-S-T. Kitchen.com.
Welcome back to NYCBD with Jeffrey Hill right here on 710 WOR Radio every Sunday morning. Also available on iHeartRadio and iTunes along with Spotify as a podcast. We're also available on Instagram, Facebook, and of course we have a YouTube site at NYCBD Official. The blog you all know, medium.com/@JeffreyHill2. All right, let's move on to the fourth segment of our show, responding to your messages. We got time for just one message, and this one comes from Angela from Natick. I grew up in Natick, so I don't know Angela, but I'm excited to listen to what she had to say.
Sure, she's now like an ex-girlfriend? Or
yeah, no, I'm sorry.
Wife or something? You know, did you check out the profile to make sure?
I did my best. They don't usually put their social proclivities in there.
Sure.
All right, so anyway, Angela says, my husband has served...
Oh, there you go.
Okay, sorry. True. All right, Flips is a good guy. He's trying to protect me. He knows I'm a single guy, and I've been trying my best to find a partner. All right, Angela says, my husband has served multiple tours and is now considering moving back to Natick Labs for his next assignment. PTSD is something he has been wrestling with for years now. It comes in waves, and has impacted his ability to parent his children and be the partner I know he wants to be. Does moving to an adult-use state help us secure cannabis as a prescription for our problem? Well, Angela, I've got good and bad news. Moving to Massachusetts allows him to secure cannabis to help with his issues by simply showing a license at a legal cannabis dispensary. The problem becomes not one of acquiring the product, he certainly can do that, but paying for it. The typical medicinal dosage for PTSD will cost approximately $8,000 to $15,000 per year and can go higher. So Massachusetts is a good first step, but until the VA, which is run by the federal government, where we all know cannabis is still considered a Class 1 drug violation, until they are prepared to back off Schedule 1 and allow the VA to utilize cannabis and also pay for it for these vets, all right? So you've only got half the answer by moving to Massachusetts. All right, ladies and gentlemen, I hope you enjoyed today's show and our guest, Jay Contessa. Special good luck to our friend Jimmy Cozier, who is about to start his touring. Indeed, I believe he's got his first gig on New Year's Eve, right? We'll be back next week for another 60 minutes of the critical issues facing cannabis and CBD, the financial implications, the political implications, and of course the societal implications. Remember, knowledge is built brick by brick. Today I got my 31st brick. Until next week, this is Jeffrey Hill with NYCBD.